Let us start today now the terminologies of accountancy. Okay, now in that first we will see business transaction. So what do you mean by business transaction? Here we'll see that business transaction means exchange of product or service of business between two or more person in the form of cash or credit. In short, when does the business transaction takes place? So when there is an exchange of product or services between two or more person, that is either they are purchasing the goods or selling the goods, okay, in front of cash or in front of credit, that is they are not paying the cash on the spot in credit transaction. Okay, so that transactions are known as business transaction. Okay, we'll see further. Business transaction means an act of business. Business transaction is always economic transaction. Okay, why? Because there is money coming into consideration. So business transaction is always an economic transaction. Economic transaction means a transaction which can be measured in terms of money. Cash transaction made in the form of money, which clearly shows us, that is depict us, depict means shows, okay. So here depict means it shows some economic value. Dues of credit transaction are receivable in future, that is when there is a credit transaction, the dues, that is the money which will get in future, okay. The money, dues means money to be received in future, because right now it is what? It is a credit transaction. So later on, after few after few days or after a few months, we will get the money. So that shows economic value. Also, the prerequisite condition of business transaction is to have its economic value. So in short, it will hold, this business transaction will hold some financial value. Okay, business transaction come into existence through the medium of cash or credit transaction. So see, here they have shown example, that is example of cash transaction also and example of credit transaction also. Okay, we'll see first. Goods of 5000 rupees sold to Rajnikant for cash. So here this is an act of business. Cash is received against good. Okay, cash is received against goods, its economic value is of rupees 5000. This is a business transaction. Okay, so here see, goods are sold to Rajnikant, and then what is happening? So he is paying the cash, that is 5000. So this is known as, because here they have written that there is for cash. Okay, so this transaction, it shows that it is a cash transaction. Then see credit transaction. So here what they have written, goods of rupees 5000 sold on credit. See, they have directly mentioned that this is on credit, okay, with a condition to pay the amount within 10 days. So he will pay the amount within 10 days. Okay, so here also the transaction is credit transaction, and it is a, that is a, goods are sold here on credit. Okay, so here in transaction, either the goods are purchased or sold, that is we can say that it is an exchange of product or services. Here either goods will be purchased or goods will be sold, or service will be given or service will be taken by someone. Okay, that is in exchange of cash or credit. Okay, so this is known as a transaction. So I hope that the word business transaction is clear with you. Now second we will see, that is event. Okay, now what do you mean by event? See, event is recognized as an incidence. Event means situation as or result created from the transaction. So when the transactions are taking place, that is purchase or sales is taking place, and whatever is the result, so what will be the result? Either it will be profit or it will be loss. Okay, so that is known as an event. Okay, so remember here that result is created from transaction. Okay, so situation or result which is created from transaction is known as event. Okay, transaction has its own explicit features which are studied as above. See, here they have given one transaction that Rajnikant is purchasing goods of rupees 3000, he is paying wages of rupees 500. Okay, so here what is there? So here they have shown that it is sales, that is first it was sales. Okay, then goods sold to Rajnikant is purchased for rupees 3000. Okay, so at what price you are selling? 5000. Okay, so here that is purchases are there, wages are there, so it was being purchased for 3000 and 5500 was for wages. Okay, so these goods are sold to Rajnikant that was purchased earlier at rupees 3000 and goods are sold at rupees 5000. So see, to him the cost of good was 3500 and now he is selling to Rajnikant at rupees 5000. So what is the difference? Profit, that is 1500 is the profit, which is the difference, and this will be treated as an event. Okay, so in short, remember the outcome of transaction. Okay, different transactions which are taking place, and whatever is the outcome or whatever is the result is known as event. Okay, then see, capital. Now what do you mean by capital? Remember, whatever amount is invested by the person in the business is known as capital. See, an investment made by the owner. Okay, so you have to remember only this keyword, that an investment made by the owner to commence the business. Commence means to start the business. Okay, so to start the business is known as capital. Okay, so remember, for capital you have to remember only this much, that whatever the investment is made by the owner to start the business is known as capital. Okay, we'll see further. Investment in business is done in cash form or in the form of any asset. Okay, it means that he can bring cash in the business, or he can also bring some asset, for example some furniture, computer, okay, so any electronic items. Okay, so that is when he is bringing all these things in the business. Okay, so that is nothing but that is asset is being brought by him in the business. So that is will be also treated as investment, and that will be also treated as capital only. Okay, so remember, here when a person is bringing cash in the business or any asset in the business, that is treated as capital. See, for example, they have given, to commence business, owner has brought 10,000 cash, furniture of rupees 6,000, goods of rupees 8,000. So here the capital for the owner will be total 24,000. So this 24,000, how it is coming? So addition of 10,000, 6,000 and 8,000. So the total of all these three amount is 24,000. So this will be treated as capital for him. That is, he is bringing 24,000, that is whatever the amount, either goods or asset, in total he is bringing 24,000 of capital in the business. Okay, see, here again, owner gives money to commence the business, that is he gives the money to start the business as well as to expand the business. Capital is identified on the basis of nature of business, which is as follow. For sole proprietor, capital word is used which owner provides. For partnership, partner's capital word is used when partners provide. For company, share capital word is used which is provided by the shareholders, that is equity share capital. This you learn in future. So only remember, when there is sole proprietor, sole proprietor means only one owner. Okay, so here there will be only one owner. So when there is only one owner, it is known as owner itself. When there is partnership, okay, so owner's capital, it is treated as owner's capital. Then partnership, what is it is known as partner's capital, what is known as. In company, it is known as share capital. Okay, so these three things you have to remember. Okay, now we will see the fourth point, that is drawings. For creation of capital, owner of business provide his personal property to the business. Personal assets given by the owner become asset of the business. When owner of business withdraw asset from the business, means cash or goods, for personal purpose, that is known as drawing. So remember this much for drawing. Okay, it is exactly opposite of capital. Okay, so here see, when owner of the business withdraw asset from the business, means cash or goods, for personal purpose. So when a person is taking something from the business for his own personal purpose, that is treated as drawing. Clear? Drawing indicates capital reduction. See, this also remember, drawing indicates capital reduction. So whatever amount you have invested in the business is known as capital. So when you are taking from amount from that for your personal purpose, so that is known as reduction in the capital. Clear? Instead deducting it directly from capital, it is shown separately as a drawing. Okay, see, when owner of business provide goods or asset, it becomes capital. Okay, when he withdraw means when he takes either asset or goods or cash, even cash also it can be there, okay? So when he is taking asset, goods or cash from the business for personal use, that becomes drawing. I hope this is clear with you, okay? Now we will start with a new point, that is liability. In short, remember that amount payable by the business for credit purchase of goods, asset or amount payable for borrowed money is known as liability. Okay, what do you mean by liability? So when there is credit purchase, okay, in short, you have purchased something on credit for which you are supposed to pay the amount in future. So that will be treated as your liability. Or you have taken loan from someone which you are supposed to repay in future. So that is also known as liability, which is here amount payable for borrowed money. Okay, borrowed money means you have taken loan from somewhere and now you are supposed to pay it. Okay, so that will be also treated as liability. This amount is payable in future. Right now you are not supposed to pay, but you will be paying it in future, so it is treated as liability. Okay, till it is not paid by the business. So until and unless you are not paying it, it will be treated as liability. Now see the types of liability. On the basis of relation, there are two types of liability: internal liability and external liability. Now in that also, on the basis of time, that is current liability. Second is non-current liability. It is also coming in internal. Same way, it is also coming in external. We will see in detail, okay, what do you mean by current liability and what do you mean by non-current liability. First, we will see that is internal liability and external liability. See, in accounting, business and owner are treated as separate entity. Your owner will be different and businessman, that is the business, will be treated differently, okay? That is his account. For example, Ram account, here he is known as a person, okay? So his account is separate, okay, in terms of accounting. And Ram and Son's shop is there, okay? So that shop is there, so that is also different. So here the business and the owner both are treated as separate entity. When owner of the business is providing capital to the business, it becomes internal liability. Here remember, when owner is providing capital to the business, here if the business is in need of money and the owner himself is bringing some of the amount from his own personal asset, okay, and he is in giving to the business, so here it will be treated as internal liability. In short, the owner has not taken the amount from somewhere else in the market, but he himself was having his own personal asset, and from that own personal asset he is bringing something in the business, then it will be treated as internal liability. In brief, the amount payable by the business to the owner is internal liability. Owner of the business has provided capital of 1 lakh and thus this 1 lakh is liability of a business towards owner. Thus it is treated as internal liability of the business. Later on, when the business is taking place and profit is earned, then later on from the business he will take this money which he has given to the business. So right now it is treated as internal liability because he himself brought some of the amount if it is needed, okay? He has not taken that amount from somewhere else in the market. Clear? Next we will see this, the amount payable by the business to the third party for credit purchase of goods, assets or service, or payable amount for borrowed money is known as external liability. When you are supposed to pay someone else who is not from your business, but he is some other party who is related to your business, in that case when you are supposed to pay to someone else, that will be treated as external liability. Here they have given example, when you are credit purchasing on credit, okay, you have purchased the goods but amount you have not paid, you are supposed to pay after 10 days or few days, okay? So in that case it will be treated as external liability. And if you are supposed to pay amount to someone else, if you have taken that amount in the form of a loan, then in that case also it will be treated as external liability. For example, 50,000 are borrowed from Bhavna Ben with the condition to redeem. Redeem means to pay, repay. Redeem means to repay, okay, after 3 years. So you are supposed to pay this amount to Bhavna Ben after 3 years. So in that case, this will be treated as external liability. Another example they have given, goods of 2,000 purchased on credit from Raman. Okay, so you have purchased from Raman, but that is on credit purchase. So that is you have to pay later on. 1,000 are outstanding for the payment of rent. So this also is one of the example. Okay, furniture of 5,000 is purchased on credit from Devang. So these all are examples of external liability. Okay. Business liability on the basis of relation. Internal liability, external liability. Again, they have shown the same thing, that is internal liability, liability towards owner is there. In case of external liability, there is a liability towards the third party. Okay. Let us see now seventh point, current liability and non-current liability. See, first of all, remember, what do you mean by current? Current means short term and non-current means long term. Clear? So this thing you have to remember, current will be always for short term period and non-current will be always for long term period. See now, as stated earlier, internal and external liability is determined on the basis of relation of business with other person, while current and non-current liability is determined on the basis of time. Its explanation is as follow. Okay, why it is on the basis of time? Because it is on the basis of short term and long term. That's why it is on the basis of time. See the explanation. A liability which is to be paid within 1 year by the business, it is known as current liability. So when any kind of liability you are supposed to pay within 1 year, so it will be treated as current liability. Current liability is treated as a short-term liability also. Generally, in short-term liability, the goods purchased on credit, expenses are outstanding, etc. are included. So these are the examples of short-term liability, which is known as current liability. Next, we will see a liability which is to be paid during the period of more than 1 year. So here you will take into consideration that is more than 1 year. So it is known as non-current liability. Non-current liability is also known as long-term liability. In non-current liability, what will be there? So bank loan, debentures, etc. Okay, what do you mean by debentures? So money taken from public by the company in the form of loan. Clear? So money taken, what do you mean by debenture? Money taken from public by the company in the form of loan. So that is known as debenture. Okay. So here this is also treated as non-current liability. Next we will go to asset. See now, liability was when you are supposed to pay the money, that is liability. Now what do you mean by asset? So when you are getting something either in cash or in the form of land, building, like that, okay, so that is which you can easily convert into cash, that is known as asset. Okay, see, there are two important aspects in business, liability and asset. We have obtained the information about liability. Now let us have information about assets. Under double entry system, at one side liability takes place and simultaneously on the other side assets emerges at the time of commencement of business, which is clear that when you prepare balance sheet, this is balance sheet, okay? So this is your liability and this is your asset. So one side it will be liability, one side simultaneously it will be asset, and the balance of both should be same, which you'll learn in future. So this is how the balance sheet is being prepared. Asset means any such tangible or intangible. Now let me make clear, what do you mean by tangible and intangible? Tangible, which you can see, touch. Intangible, which is not seen and you cannot touch. So asset means any such tangible or intangible product or item is of ownership of business and has some economic value. It means it has hold some value. For example, if you are having land of 20 lakhs, so you are having land which you can easily convert into cash. What is the economic value? What is the financial value for that land? So that is 20 lakhs. In other words, assets mean economic resources which are held by the owner and from which there is expectation of economic benefit, which I told that you can easily convert that into cash whenever needed. So that is known as asset. See, here they have shown you types of asset: non-current asset, current assets and fictitious asset. We will see in detail what do you mean by non-current asset, current asset and fictitious asset. See, first we will see that is non-current asset. Non-current assets are identified on the basis of time. Again, as you studied non-current liability, same way it is non-current asset. So this will be also on the basis of time. Non-current means long term. Like non-current liability, non-current assets are also for the period for more than 1 year. So it will be more than 1 year, so long term. They are known as long term asset or fixed asset. So the another name of non-current asset is, that is long-term asset or fixed asset. So remember, you can say it as non-current asset or long-term assets or fixed assets. Okay, all are one and the same. They are known as long-term assets or fixed assets. Example is there, land and building. So these are all examples of non-current asset. Land and building, plant, machineries. See, your plant means the place where the factory is being located. Okay, so remember, plant means what? Where the factory, your business, okay, where the production is taking place, that place is known as plant. Machineries, furniture, trademark, copyright, patent, goodwill, franchise, etc. are included in non-current asset. We will see later on what do you mean by all this. Okay, clear? So these assets have life of more than 1 year. Non-current assets can be categorized into further two categories, that is tangible asset and intangible asset. These all types of asset which are being shown here, okay, this can be classified into two categories. One is tangible asset and one is intangible asset. Okay, tangible means which you can see in physical existence. See here. Tangible assets are those assets which are having physical existence. Tangible assets can be seen and can be touched. Okay, so what you'll remember, it can be seen, it can be touched. Tangible assets are subcategory of non-current asset. Okay, so it is a part of non-current asset. Intangible asset, what is there? So land, building, plant, machinery, furniture, etc. are included. Now we will see what do you mean by intangible asset. Intangible word itself clarifies the meaning that these assets, okay, of these assets, intangible assets do not hold any physical existence. As it does not hold any physical existence, therefore it cannot be seen, it cannot be touched. Examples are there, trademark, copyright, patent, goodwill. Okay, these are the examples of intangible asset. Now we will see what do you mean by all this. Okay, first is trademark. So you might have seen product, okay, that is Amul. On Amul, there is a trademark. One girl is there. Same way, Nirma washing powder, one girl is there. Ambuja cement, the elephant has been shown. So that picture which is shown on the product, outer part of the product, okay, that is on the appearance of that product, that is known as trademark. Copyright. Now, what do you mean by copyright? It means only you have the right to issue that particular product, okay, or only you have the right to give that particular service. For example, if CDs are there, cassettes are there, they have copyright. Films are there, so they have copyright that only this particular production house can issue or can publish the CDs. Okay, they can only send the CDs in the markets, so that are original CDs, so that is because of copyright. Patent. Patent is nothing but in case of some design or some formula, when you are finding and except you, no one else can use that particular formula or that particular design. For example, you take any car, okay, BMW. So there is a particular design, only you can use that design, or some particular medicine is there, only you have the formula and only you can prepare that particular medicine. So when you are owning that design or you are owning that particular formula, in that case you have to take the patent of that particular formula or design. So that is known as patent. Goodwill. Goodwill is the reputation of your business in the market. If your business is old and your business is well known in the market, so it will hold some monetary value. That monetary value of that particular business is known as goodwill. So these are the examples of intangible asset. Now we will see point number 12, that is current assets. These assets are of that kind whose time duration is less than 1 year. We have seen the current word in current liability also, that for less than 1 year it is current asset. These assets can be converted into cash easily. For day-to-day transaction of business, these assets are used. In current assets, cash balance, bank balance, debtors, bills receivable, raw material stock, finished stock, etc. are included. See, cash balance, you all know. Bank balance, that is amount in your bank account. Debtors, debtors are those party from you are whom you are supposed to take money. Okay, so you can remember that debtors from whom you receive money. Bills receivable also, that is when credit sales takes place. Okay, in that case bills receivable is coming into consideration. That also you'll learn in future. Raw material which you are having already, finished stock. So all these are known as current assets from which you can easily get the money. A product for which trading is done by business is known as goods of business. For example, grain is a good for the businessman of grain. Okay, so here the goods are treated as whatever you are selling. If you are selling some product, so that product is treated as goods. 13th point, that is liquid assets. Liquid assets are recognized as subcategory of current asset. It is a part of current asset. In short, all current asset excluding stock are recognized as liquid asset. So here what you are supposed to remember, all the current asset only exclude stock out of that. Why we are not including stock? Because stock is whatever you have produced, and that production will go to the market and then it will be sold. Okay, so it is not very easy for us to sell it fast. So that's why when you are supposed to calculate liquid asset, in that you are not supposed to take stock into consideration. So exclude the stock, and then it other items, that is cash balance, bank balance, bills receivable, all this you can easily, debtors, all this you can easily convert into cash. But stock, you have supposed to go and find out some customer, then only you can convert it into cash. That's why it is not very easy to get it into converted into cash. So we are not including that stock into liquid assets. These assets excluding stock can be converted into cash quickly. It means in short period. For example, debtors, bills receivable, etc. can be easily converted into cash. So here only you remember, what do you mean by liquid assets? So that assets which are very easy to be converted in, which are very easily converted into cash. Okay, and stock is not very easily converted into cash, as we need to find out some customers who can purchase the stock. Next we will see, that is real assets. Real assets means assets that have value in reality. These assets have market price. This means it has some realizable value. These assets can be converted into cash. In these assets, tangible, intangible and current assets are included. From sale of such assets, if money can be realized, then they are known as real asset. Through sale of real assets, cash can be procured. That is, whichever asset is easy, you can convert it into cash, that are all known as real assets, which you can go and sell in the market. Okay. Next is fictitious asset. See, what do you mean by fictitious asset? Fictitious assets do not have physical form. That is, realizable value of fictitious asset is zero. Remember this also, that what is the realizable value? It means you cannot get anything from this particular fictitious asset. The realizable value is zero. These assets cannot be converted into cash. This is non-recurring expenses. It is also, what is the another name of fictitious asset? So non-recurring expenses. See, what do you mean by that? The benefit of this expense is available for the period of more than 1 year. This amount is to be written off in certain years, thus shown as an asset. Every year, predetermined amount is written off and shown as an expense. For example, they have given issue cost of share and debenture. That is, once only you are supposed to issue the shares, but the amount, whatever amount you are receiving from the shares and debentures from the market, you can use till for a long time period. Okay. Then next is preliminary expenses, share or debenture discount, See, I will give you one example of preliminary expenses. For example, if there is a whitewash done in your building, in this year you are doing whitewash, okay, coloring to your walls. Now this whitewash will continue for a long time period, for 5 or 7 years. Then after 7 years, you will have to do again. So for 7 years, so though the expense is taking place in this year, but the benefit of this will be taking place for many years. Same way, leveling the ground. So that is any playground or anything in the club. So leveling the ground, only once you have to do, and the benefit of that will take place for a long period of time. So these are all example of preliminary expenses. Share or debenture discount, again, when you are issuing share and you are giving discount, so that will also be received for a long time period. So all these are examples of that is fictitious asset. Thus, here the expense is taking place in 1 year, but the benefit of that expense is spreading for many years. So here it is also known as spread revenue expenses or deferred revenue expenses. So the another name for fictitious asset is spread revenue expenses or deferred revenue expenses. Next we will go, that is receipt. When money is received due to consequence of business transaction, it is known as receipt. In short, remember, when you are receiving money because of some of the transaction which is taking place, it is known as receipt. These receipts are classified on the basis of their nature. Receipts regularly received during the year and not regularly received during the year. Business receive regular receipt from day-to-day activities. For example, receipt of sale in business, receipt of commission, receipt of dividend. These receipts are received on regular basis. Certain receipts do not have regular nature. These receipts are thus categorized into two categories: regular receipt, which is known as revenue receipt; capital receipt, which is known as, which are not regular in nature. So see, what do you mean by receipt? The amount which you are going to receive. Capital receipt, the amount which you will be receiving after a long period of time, that is, you are not going to receive on regular basis. Revenue receipt, such receipts which you are going to receive on regular basis throughout the year. We'll see in detail, that is capital receipt. This receipt is not received regularly. This receipt is procured from the sale of asset. This receipt is obtained by issuing debentures. Asset is not sold frequently. Again and again, you are not going to sell your asset every time. Debentures are not issued frequently. Why debentures are not issued frequently by the company? Because it is considered as loan. So again and again, the company will not take money from public. Okay? Otherwise, their liability will increase. So here in this case also, debentures and assets are not sold on regular basis. So you will not find out this on a frequent basis. These are not received frequently. So such kind of receipts are known as capital receipt. Next is revenue receipt. The flow of these receipts would remain constant. From this receipt, profit earned during the year or loss incurred can be ascertained. So remember this also, that from this either you can find out profit or loss. Why? Because what you are receiving, that will show you, okay, that how much income is earned. In this category of receipt, income of sale, income of commission, income of discount, income of rent are included. This kind of receipts arise frequently. Revenue receipt is also known as revenue income. What is the another name of revenue receipt? So revenue receipt is also known as revenue income. Now we will see point number 19, that is payment. Money paid due to consequences of business transaction is known as payment. So whenever you are paying someone, so that comes under payment. These payments are again classified on the basis of their nature. Payment regularly paid during the year and not regularly paid during the year. Same way as we have seen in receipts, that is capital receipt and revenue receipt. So here also we will see capital expenditure and revenue expenditure. Okay, let us see in this paragraph. For example, see, business is run in rented premises and rent is paid regularly every month. This is a regular payment every month. It means you have taken the place on rent and you are every month paying regularly the rent. So this is the payment which is taking place on throughout the year on regular basis. Now assume that machine is purchased for business. This expenditure is not regular. Okay, every month you are not going to go and purchase the machinery, or every year you will not purchase one new machinery. It will take place occasionally. So like receipts and payments are also classified into two categories, that is capital expenditure and revenue expenditure. First, capital expenditure. This payment is not regular in nature. Generally, when fixed assets are purchased, capital expenditure arises. So when does capital expenditure arises? So whenever you are purchasing some asset, in that circumstances, capital expenditure takes place. For example, purchase of machine. Assets are not purchased frequently. Thus, it is capital expenditure. The redemption of debenture is also a capital payment. Redemption means repayment. That is, you are repaying. And what was debenture? So, loan taken by company from public. So, the loan amount which you have taken from the public, now you are repaying it back. So this is also known as capital expenditure. Then we will see revenue expenditure. The flow of this payment would remain constant. That is, on regular basis you will pay the amount. In this category, payment of salary, wages, telephone expense, advertisement expenses, etc. are included. So these expenses you are going to take place every month. So this will be coming under revenue expenditure. Next is deferred revenue expenses, which we have already seen as a fictitious asset. We have already discussed in point number 15. Then expenses. The amount spent and benefit of which is available in the respective accounting year is expense. Accounting year is of 12 months. For example, your accounting period is from April to March, and in that time period only, whatever expenses you are bearing, whatever payments you are doing, so that are all treated as expenses. This is called revenue expenses. Example, salary expense, wages expense, brokerage expense, commission expense, discount expense. All these are examples of expenses. So here you are supposed to remember what will be treated as expense. So the expenses which are taking place in one accounting year, that is for 12 months. So all that expenses are treated as expense. Revenue. Goods and services are sold and provided to the customers respectively. If credit sales are made and amount is receivable, it is also revenue. Okay. Credit sale is taking place. Later on in few months you will get the money, or in few days you will get the money. So this will be also treated as receivable, that is revenue. Beside other income, interest, rent, all these are your incomes. Interest received, rent received, commission received, dividend received for the respective period. That is again same accounting period. Okay. So for that same accounting period of 12 months, and event outstanding are included in revenue. Outstanding means which are not yet received. So that these all are treated as revenue. Let us see next point. Profit. After deduction of regular payment, which is known as revenue payment, and regular receipt, which is known as revenue receipt for the year, the remaining surplus is known as profit. Clear? So one side there is receipt. For example, you are receiving 15,000 and you are paying 10,000. So what will be the amount of your profit? That will be 5,000. The excess amount, that is surplus amount. Okay, the surplus means excess amount. So that excess or surplus amount is treated as profit. The excess of day-to-day income over expenses of the business is called profit. For example, if they're asking what do you mean by profits, this you can write down. That is the excess of income. See, here I have given income is, for example, 15,000 rupees and expenses are of rupees 10,000. So see, income will be more, then only you will get profit. If income is less, suppose income is 10,000 and expenses are 15,000, then you will get loss. Okay, which we'll see here, that is loss. So see, in account, this kind of profit is computed from profit and loss account. So for this, we are supposed to prepare profit and loss account. How we will prepare profit and loss account? So see, this is your profit and loss account. This is just a rough, I am giving idea, okay? This side, you will record all the expenses. This side, you will record all the incomes, okay? And gains. And this side, all the expenses and losses. Okay, the difference of this account will be treated as profit. Okay, that is the difference which you will get on this side. See, this side, if you are getting, that is 15,000. And this side, the total is coming to 10,000. So the difference will come here, that is 5,000, so this will be treated as your profit. Clear? So this is an example of profit and loss account. I have just given in a summary form. This kind of profit is called revenue profit, because this profit is the difference of revenue income and revenue expenses, that is your day-to-day expenses and day-to-day income. This is regular profit, but many times there is a creation of irregular profit which is known as capital profit. The profit which you receive for a long time of period, that is after a long time period, that is sometimes in a year. So that is known as capital profit. The profit which you are receiving on a regular basis every month, that profit will be treated as regular profit or revenue profit. Next is loss. The computation of loss is contrary to profit computation, that is exactly opposite. The difference obtained by deduction of regular income from regular expense is called loss. This is called revenue loss. Deficit word is popular for the loss in practice. Okay, that is, many times loss is also known as deficit. In other, you can do exactly opposite of this example. Okay, if here there is 15,000 and here there is 10,000, that is expenses are 15,000 and incomes are 10,000 total, so there will be loss because expenses are more compared to income, so this will be treated as deficit. In another type of loss, there can be happening of loss without doing any kind of activity. This is also recorded in books of account. For example, goods destroyed by fire. See, we have not done anything, but the goods, whatever goods were lying down in the godown or shop, have been destroyed by fire. So if the cost of these goods is 5,000, then loss will be also 5,000. Sometimes goods are stolen away, destroyed in transit. In transit, that is, they are in transportation, they are transferring from moving from one place to another, and in between, on the way, something happens, so that is known as destroyed in transit due to accident. Goods destroyed due to rain, all are examples of this kind of loss, which they have shown that without anything the goods, that is the loss, have been taken place. If any asset meets with an accident, this event is also treated as loss. Any asset is sold less than book value, amount which is not received, is also called loss. Okay, see, any asset sold less than book value, suppose book value is 10,000 and you are selling that cost asset at 9,000 rupees, so here what will be, that is 1,000 will be loss. Okay, this is known as capital loss. Now we will move to point number 27, that is gain. See, what do you mean by gain? Profit and gain are popular as synonyms. Okay, whatever is your profit, that is only your gain. Now move to point number 28, that is purchase. Many items or services are purchased in the business. All these purchases are not treated as purchase of business. They are expenses of business. A businessman does the business of goods. Purchase of that goods is treated as purchase in accounting. For example, when stationery is purchased by grain merchant, it is stationery expense. But if he purchases grain, it is treated as purchase. This purchase can be in cash or in credit form. Now, what you have to understand here, that in whichever item you are dealing, and if you are purchasing that product, then only it will be treated as purchase. If you have a utensils business and you are purchasing some utensils, then it will be treated as purchase. But if you are purchasing some books to record the entries of your purchase and sales, then in that case, the purchase of that particular book will be treated as a stationery. Okay, so that will be treated as your stationery expense and not as your purchase. Now moving to point number 29, that is sales. Businessman receives different types of incomes from business. All these incomes are not treated as sale. A businessman does the business of goods, sell that goods will be treated as sales in accounting. Income generated by grain merchant through sale of grain is called sales. Same example which I have given for purchase is applicable for sales also. In whichever item you are dealing, that only will be treated as sales if you are selling that particular item. But if you are selling something else rather than your business, then it will not be treated as sales. Next item, that is stock. Goods purchased by businessmen for business purpose, trading purpose, goods remain unsold from that goods is called as stock. For example, if you are having goods of rupees 20,000 and you have sold out from that of rupees 15,000, The remaining stock of 5,000 will be known as your closing stock, as your stock, because that in future you will sell that particular product and you will gain the amount. See, here they've given example again. We'll see that a businessman has purchased goods of rupees 70,000, out of which that goods worth rupees 45,000 sold for 75,000. Then stock will be of 25,000. See, we are having goods of 70,000. Okay, out of that we are selling the goods of rupees 45,000. So what will be the remaining amount left out with us? That is 25,000. So that will be treated as stock. At the end of the accounting year, the closing stock and closing stock are one and the same. The closing stock would be rupees 25,000 and it would be the opening stock of rupees 25,000 for the next year. This year closing stock will be opening for the next year. Closing stock is your current asset. See why it is current asset? Current asset we have already seen. Okay, that is short term asset. In short term, you can convert that amount into cash. That's why closing stock is known as current asset. In brief, stock means surplus of goods from purchase. Surplus means remaining, left out, whatever you have purchased, okay, and left out with you, which you are unable to sell, that is known as your stock. The next item is, that is debtors. When a businessman sells goods on credit to his own customer, those customers are called debtors. Customer becomes debtors of that amount for which goods is sold on credit. Debtors are treated as current asset because in short term you will get the money. Short time you will get the money. You can recover the money from the debtors. So in short, who are debtors? So from whom you have to take money is known as debtors. And when debtors is there, so when there is credit sales, there is debtors. Okay, so you have to remember that debtors are related to sales. Okay, so remember S and D. When there is credit sale, then there will be debtors. Okay, so remember like this. Then next topic is bills receivable. See, now what do you mean by that? It is one type of return document. Bills receivable is a return document where there are two parties. One is the bill writer and other is the bill acceptor. In short, one is the seller and one is the purchaser. Okay, when bill writer acquire right to receive certain amount as per predetermined date in future. See, bill writer, he has sold something, so, and the other will be the bill acceptor. Okay, so buyer or purchaser, we can say he will accept the bill because he will give the money later on. Okay, the purchaser. So when the bill receivable is created, again when there is credit sales, okay, during that time only the bills receivable are created. See, we'll see further. Where bill writer acquire right to receive certain amount as per predetermined date in future, it becomes receivable. Bill is a bills receivable for the bill writer. In this return document, bill acceptor accept the return responsibility to pay specified amount. So who is the bill acceptor? That is the purchaser or the buyer. He accept the responsibility that on a later on date, that is, he will pay the specified amount on maturity date. See, that the date will come on later on, which is pre-decided by the buyer and the seller. Generally, bill receivable emerges from debtors. Okay, so here you can understand that bills receivable are emerging from debtors, and debtors are created, so when there is credit sales. Okay, so this is a link that credit sales will be there. Then who is created out of them? So debtors. And if you need on the spot money, then what is created? So bills receivable. Suppose here I will give you an example. The debtor is supposed to get the money out, that is after 30 days. Now he does not want to wait for 1 month. He wants the money in urgency. So what he will do? He will go to bank. And with the buyer, he will do an agreement. He will have a return agreement, and in that return agreement, it will be created as bills receivable. So what the seller will do, he will take this bills receivable to the bank, and bank will give the money on behalf of the buyer. Now after maturity date, or that is after 30 days or 1 month, okay, the time will come. So on that time period, the purchaser will pay the amount not to debtors, but he will pay the amount to the bank authorities. Okay, so that is known as bills receivable. So when the bills receivable are created, so when the debtors are needing the money in urgency and they are not ready to wait for 1 month or whatever the credit period is there, so in that circumstances the seller will create bills receivable, and this will bills receivable he will take to the bank, he will generate the cash from there, and afterwards on the maturity date, whenever the date is coming, the specified amount will be paid by the purchaser to the bank authorities. Clear? In this regard, detailed discussion
Thank you. Accommodation bills are also popular in practice. So these are also, you can see that they are very popular nowadays. In this regard, detailed discussion is made in a separate chapter. We will see this bills receivable separately in part 2 of your accounts textbook. Now we'll go to point number 33, that is receivable. Any amount to be received by businessmen in the future from any person or persons is known as receivables. Okay, that is, in short, you can say it as outstanding. Okay, the amount which you are going to receive in future, till now you have not received. Examples they have given: debtors and bills receivable are included in receivable. In other receivable, commission outstanding, which I said now, that outstanding, whatever is the remaining amount which you are going to receive, that is, in short, outstanding incomes. Okay, you can see here debtors, bills receivable, outstanding incomes. What are the examples of outstanding incomes? So commission outstanding, rent outstanding, interest outstanding, and next is prepaid expense. See, you have paid in advance, so right now what you will think, you will take it back. Okay, so you, when you're going to take it back, you're really not going to take it back, but in the books of accounts you will show that you will take this amount back, because this you have prepaid. What do you mean by prepaid? That this is of not this year, but for the next year you have paid in advance. That is known as prepaid. So prepaid is also treated as receivable, because in the books of account you'll show that as if you are going to take it back. Actually, we are not going to take it back, but we'll just assume it in the books of accounts. So these are all the known as receivables, the money which you are going to receive in future. Next, that is creditors. As businessman does credit sale, in the same way he undertakes credit purchase. A person from whom goods are purchased on credit, that particular person become creditor of the business. A trader become creditor of the business for the amount for which goods are purchased on credit. Creditors are treated as current liability. Okay, so who are creditors? To whom you have to pay money. To whom you have to pay money. Okay, again, so when there is credit purchase, in that cases what will be there? So there will be creditors. Okay, so here you can remember that the connection is between P and C, that is PC, personal computer. Like that you remember for creditors, that is, to whom creditors are connected. So creditors are connected to purchases. Okay, same way I told you with whom debtors are connected. So debtors are connected with sales. So SD, you can remember it in shortcut, that like this, that SD card. Okay, so SD means sales are connected with debtors, and PC, that is personal computers, that is purchases, are connected with creditors. Okay, and creditors are one type of current liability, because in short time period you are supposed to pay the money. Same way debtors are current assets, creditors are current liability. Next we'll see that is bills payable. Again, same opposite of bills receivable. Okay, so bills payable is a return document where there are two parties. Again, there will be bill writer and bill acceptor. Well, bill acceptor accept responsibility to pay the certain amount as per the predetermined date in future, it becomes payable. Okay, bill acceptor, here the person who is purchasing. Okay, again the same sequence will be there. See here, what was happening? Credit sales, then debtors, and then bills receivable. So here again, what is there? So creditors are there. Okay, creditors are connected with whom? So credit purchase. And then what is there? So there will be bills payable. Okay, so same link it is going on. So in case of bills payable, the bill acceptor pay the amount written in the bill to the bill writer on maturity date. Generally, bills payable emerges from creditor. Again, the same link is there, that when the bills are supposed to be paid. Okay, so he is supposed to pay, but again the opposite party, where I have given you the example of bills receivable. Okay, the seller will be bills receivable and the purchaser will be bills payable. So the same example is applicable here also in case of bills payable. Clear? Next is payables. Again, it is opposite of receivables. In case when you are supposed to pay the money, okay, or you are supposed to, sorry, you are supposed to receive the money. In case of receivable, you are supposed to receive the money from person in future, and in payables you are supposed to pay the money to the person in future. Okay, so any amount to be paid by the business person in the future to any person or persons is known as payables. Creditors, bills payables are included in payables. Same way, see,
debtors are included in bills receivables, so creditors are included in payables. Bills receivable are included in receivables, so here bills payable are included in payables. Here there is outstanding income, so here there is outstanding expense. Here there is prepaid expense, so here there will be income received in advance, which is known as pre-received income. Pre-received income. So they are exactly opposite of each other. Okay. In case of receivable, you will be getting the money, and in case of payables, you are supposed to pay the money in future. Clear? Next is cost. To produce any product or to provide any service, whatever expenses are required, the sum of these expenses is known as cost. See, all of you have studied. What do you mean by cost price? So cost price is the price of that particular product, okay? That is the expenses to manufacture that particular product is known as cost price. So here same way, cost is what? So to produce any product or to provide any service, whatever the expenses are incurred, that sum of expenses, that is the total. Sum means total. So the total of all these expenses, okay, that is known as cost. Generally in cost, raw material cost, labor cost and other costs are included. That is, for example, if you are producing any shirt, so the raw material cost, that is the cost of that particular cloth, then the labor charges, okay, which you will pay to some person who will prepare the shirts from that cloth material, and other expenses, that is other cost, for example, electricity expenses or any other expenses, that all. So these all, when you will do the total of this, so this will be coming, which is known as cost. Okay. Next is voucher. Voucher is nothing but that is a bill. Okay. So whenever any transaction takes place, okay, and the voucher is given, the bill is given, so that is a return document for the business transaction. Okay. So voucher is a return document of business transaction. A type of transaction is determined on the basis of voucher. A type of transaction like cash transaction, credit transaction, purchase transaction, sales transaction, transaction with banks, expense transaction, income transaction. So on that particular bill, each and everything will be recorded, that this voucher is based on what basis. So voucher is nothing but that is a return document, that is a proof of the business transaction. We'll see further. Asset transaction, liability transaction, etc. are determined from voucher. After deciding the type of transaction, transactions are recorded in the books of accounts according to the rules of account. Clear? Next is discount. Emergence of discount is from purchase and sale. Where you can see discounts, so discounts normally are available on purchase and sales. Many times from total amount of purchase or sale, as per the condition, certain amount is deducted and net amount is paid. The amount which is deducted from the total amount is known as discount. This you have to learn, that is, what do you mean by discount? So the amount which is deducted from the total amount is known as discount. Clear? Out of the total amount of purchase sale, the amount which is procured or deducted is known as discount. So now how many types of discounts are there? There are two types of discount, that is trade discount and cash discount, that we'll see further. But the discount word is clear. For example, you are going and purchasing something. The cost of that item is 150, and suppose that fellow, the shopkeeper, is giving you discount of rupees 10, so that you will be costing, that is 140. Okay, so 10 rupees is your discount. You all know discount is a famous word. Okay, now what do you mean by trade discount and what do you mean by cash discount? We'll see that. At the time of sales, a businessman deducts certain percentage amount from the sales price. It is known as trade discount. See, this is for whom? This is for the businessman. Okay, so trade discount, normally who receives trade discount? So business person receive trade discount. Who is giving? Maybe the wholesaler or maybe the manufacturer is giving the trade discount to the businessman. The trade discount is not recorded in the books of accounts. Okay, remember this also. Which discount is not recorded in the books of accounts? So trade discount is not recorded in the books of account. You will calculate, but you will not record it. Okay. Assume that the goods worth rupees 10,000 sold at 2% trade discount. In case from selling price 10,000, after deducting 2%, see, so 10,000, what is the amount of 2%? So that is 200. So at what amount the sales will be recorded? So 9,800 will be recorded in the books of accounts as sales. Okay. So just remember right now that trade discount is always given to the businessman. Who will give? So the wholesaler or the manufacturer will give this discount to the businessman. Okay. Next is cash discount. To attract the customer. Now see, what is the basic difference? Trade discount is received by businessman.
cash discount is received by the customer. So who is receiving cash discount? So customers are receiving the cash discount with the purpose to receive quick collection of credit sales. The amount which is deducted from the receivable amount is known as cash discount. Cash discount is recorded in the books. Another difference between trade discount is not recorded in the books, whereas cash discounts are recorded in the books. After deducting of trade discount, cash discount is determined. So whenever the transactions are coming, first you have to calculate trade discount. After calculating trade discount, then only you have to calculate the cash discount. Okay. As above stated in A, if 200 rupees as discount is allowed, see here in this case they have given that on 10,000 goods are sold, 2% is trade discount. So after deducting 2%, what you are getting? 9,800. Now on this 9,800, again suppose if there is discount, that is cash discount of 200 rupees. So what will be the amount? That is 9,600 to the supplier. Thus 200 will be treated as cash discount. This discount is allowed at the time of collection of cash. Thus it is called cash discount. See, what do you mean by this line? This discount is only allowed at the time of collection of cash. It means whenever you are doing any credit transaction, cash discount is not there. Okay. So remember, on credit transactions, cash discount is not available. Okay, you have to remember, as the word is cash discount, it is always available for the cash transaction. On credit transaction, cash discount is not available. Then see, discount received or discount allowed. First we will see that is discount received or discount allowed or cash discount. Both are treated as cash discount. This discount is recorded in the books. As it is cash discount, we have seen that cash discounts are to be recorded in the book. Discount received is treated as income and discount allowed is treated as expense. See, discount received, it means you have received the discount, so therefore it is your income. Discount allowed, it means you have given discount to someone else, so it will be treated as expense. See here, further they have given discount received when a businessman, they have given with example, when a businessman purchases goods and pays less amount, amount which is not paid is called discount received. Okay, this is income of business. For example, goods of rupees 10,000 purchased from Ramila Ben at 2% discount will be allowed if the amount is paid in 15 days. So here, if the amount is paid in 15 days, then only she will get 2% discount, otherwise she will not get 2% discount. Now see, if rupees 10,000 are paid to Ramila Ben within 15 days, in this case, instead of 10,000, now if she is paying the amount in within 15 days, as she is paying the amount within 15 days, 2% discount will be available to her. What is the amount of 2%? That is 2% on 10,000, so that is 200. So now what will be the amount? That is 9,800, that is 10,000 minus 200 will be paid. Now rupees 200 will be treated as discount received. This will be recorded in the books. Next is discount allowed. When businessman sells goods and receive less amount, see, discount received is when purchase transaction takes place. Discount allowed is when sales transaction is takes place. So keep this also into consideration. When you are purchasing something, you get the discount. When you are selling something, you give discount to others. And receive less amount which is not received is called discount allowed. This is expense of business. For example, goods of 15,000 sold to Kalpana Ben. If amount is received in 10 days, 2% discount will be allowed. If the collection is received from Kalpana Ben within 10 days in place of rupees 15,000, then 14,700, that is the discount amount is how much? 2% on 15,000, that is 300. So you will deduct from this, and now 300 will be treated as discount allowed, and you will receive only this much amount, 14,700, from her. And this discount allowed will be treated as expense. So discount received is treated as income. Discount allowed is treated as expense. Next is that is depreciation. Depreciation is an expense of business. Every year the value of asset is reduced by certain rate. Amount which is reduced is called depreciation. What you will remember, amount which is reduced on asset. Okay? Or you can say the reduction on the value of asset is known as depreciation. Before making tax payment to the government, depreciation is deducted. Depreciation is non-cash expense of the business. Another important thing you will remember, depreciation is a non-cash expense. For this, I'll just give you an example. See, if a pencil is there, if this pencil I'm using continuously, what will be happening? The size of the pencil will go on reducing and reducing. Same way, in business, when you're using some asset or some machinery continuously, after some time period or after years, what will happen? The value of that particular machine will comes to zero. Now, what you have to do? The businessmen, they are deducting a certain amount every year from that value of machinery. Why they are doing so? For example, the life of machine is 10 years. The day when the machine is purchased for rupees 10, for example, if it is purchased of rupees 1 lakh, every year what the businessman will do, he will deduct 10%, that is 1 lakh 10%. The amount is 1 lakh, and if you calculate 10% depreciation on it, the amount will be 10,000 rupees. Every year this 10,000 he will keep aside in the business. He will deduct from this asset, and that amount he will be keeping aside. He will not pay this amount to anyone. That's why it is known as non-cash expense, because he is not going to give to anyone, or nor even this 10,000 he is using. He will keep this money aside. After 10 years, when this lump sum amount, every year he is keeping 10,000 separately somewhere. So after 10 years, the lump sum amount will become again 1 lakh. Now after 10 years, when this particular machinery, the value becomes zero, it means it is of no use. You cannot use that machine, as it is old machinery. What you will do? So this amount which you have kept aside in the business with this 10,000, and now the lump sum amount after 10 years, it has become again 1 lakh. What you can do? Again, you can purchase a new machinery with this money. So why they are doing so? In business, they do not want to face any financial scarcity. After 10 years, again, if they want to take out 1 lakh rupee from the business, they will face financial scarcity. They can't take that money. So what they are doing, every year they are keeping certain amount aside in the form of depreciation, and that amount after 10 years it will become lump sum amount, and with that lump sum amount again they can go and purchase the machinery. So they are not supposed to face any financial scarcity in the business. This 10,000 they are not paying to someone, they are only keeping aside. That's why it is known as non-cash expense. That is known as depreciation. I hope the concept is clear. Next is bad debt. When goods are sold on credit by business, person to whom goods are sold is known as debtor for us, because from him we will collect the amount. Many times debtors of business may not be in a position to pay full amount due to his weak financial condition. Now he is not able to pay the full amount. For example, you are supposed to take 10,000 from him. He is not in a condition to pay you full amount. He is only able to pay you 7,000. So now he is paying only 7,000 to you, and he is not paying 3,000 rupees. So that 3,000 will be treated as bad debt, because he is not in a position to pay you that particular 3,000 rupees. So that will be treated your loss. See, if the amount is not collected even after necessary effort, you have waited for a long time period, you have given him many time instruction, but then too, after a year also or after months also, he is not going to pay you, and he is not ready to pay you because his financial condition is not so. So the amount which is not received is known as bad debt. Bad debt is not an expense, but it is a loss. So remember, bad debt is not an expense, but it is treated as a loss. Next we will see, that is solvent. In accounting, a person who pays his financial obligations regularly and whose assets are more than liability, that person is known as a solvent person. It means financial obligations. What do you mean by financial obligation? Whatever he is supposed to pay, he is paying the amount regularly. Whatever amount, whatever liabilities he is having, okay? Whatever liabilities or whatever expenses, he is paying all his liabilities regularly. He is paying all his expenses regularly. And he has more assets than liability. So that person is solvent. It means his financial condition is good. Okay, so when his financial condition is good, so then that person will be treated as solvent. Again, insolvent. So opposite of this, here the financial condition is good, so here the financial condition is not good, and he is not in a condition to pay his expenses or liability. So that person will be treated as insolvent person. In accounting, a person who does not pay his financial obligation regularly, it means he is not in a position to pay these obligations and whose assets are less than liability. Your assets are also less than liability. So that person is known as insolvent person. Unless the person is declared insolvent by court, he cannot be treated as insolvent. See, who has to declare him insolvent? Not any person will be declaring him as insolvent. Not even he himself will declare him as insolvent. The court will declare him as insolvent that he is not in a condition to pay any amount. So then that person will be treated as insolvent. Clear? Then see, debit and credit. There are two important words for accounting. Every transaction has two effects in double entry system. Debit and credit. See, whichever transactions you will see further, each and every transaction will be having two effects. So one, it will be having debit, and other, it will be having credit. So true and fair understanding of debit and credit is true and fair understanding of accounting. In accounting, two sides are used. The left hand side in accounting is called as debit side. The right hand side in accounting is called as credit side. I'll show you the format for this. See, suppose you are going to give the journal entry. This you will learn in future. Right now I'm just showing you. Okay, the format of journal entry is like this: serial number, particulars, LF, debit, credit. Okay, so like this we are supposed to prepare the table for the transaction. Whatever this LF, I'll explain later on, that is known as ledger folio number, but in detail I'll explain later on. Then debit and credit. Okay, so this side is known as debit and this side is known as credit. If I give you one example, that purchased goods of rupees 10,000. Again, this also you will learn with the help of rules, but right now I just want to show you what you mean by debit and what do you mean by credit. That's why I'm giving the journal entry. Later on you will understand the journal entry very nicely. Okay, so what will be the journal entry for this transaction? So purchase account debited to cash account. See, you have purchased the goods are coming, so it will be debited. And what is going, when you are purchasing the goods, the cash is going from you. So your 10,000, your credit side, that is cash. So see, for this one transaction there is two effect. One is on debit side and one is on credit side. Okay, is that clear to you? See, we will see here. In accounting, two sides are used. The left hand side in accounting is called debit side. See, this is left hand side, this is known as debit side. This is right hand side, this is your credit side. Okay, so what they have given, the right hand side in accounting is called credit side. Any account to be debited means accounting treatment at debit side of account, that is the treatment at left hand side. Any account to be credited means accounting treatment at credit side, that means on right hand side. Discussion about rules of debit and credit is undertaken subsequently. That is, in the next chapter you will learn all these rules. Okay, why the purchase here, when I am showing you that purchase account debited, why it is on debit side only and not on credit side, that you will learn in future. Okay, so don't not worry, just right now understand that for any transaction there will be two effect. One is on debit side and one is on credit side. The left hand side is debit, the right hand side is credit. Then see account. Business transaction pertaining to certain item and person would take place frequently. This transaction may be debit side having debit effect or may be credit side having credit effect. Transaction pertaining to respective item or person is recorded at one place from where the summary of transaction of that item or person can be obtained. It is called account. In simple words, I'll show you. For example, purchases are done. Okay, so you will prepare like this account. Okay, that is particulars, amount, particulars and amount. Okay, this is nothing but this is your purchase account. Again, this side is your debit side and this side is your credit side. Clear? So this is known as purchase account. See here, they have given an example.
Pushpa Ben is a customer of a business. Goods are sold on credit to her. Assume that credit sales are made 20 times in a year and she also settles her account 20 times. Now there will be 20 into 2, 40 transactions. That is dual transaction. Each transaction have two effects. So there will. That's why they have done 20 multiplied by 2. So total how many transactions will take place? That is 40 transactions with Pushpa Ben during the year. All these transactions are recorded at one place in the books of account. Where all these transactions are recorded is called Pushpa Ben's account. Pushpa Ben is a person, thus it is a personal account. See why it is known as a personal account? Because she is a person. Like personal account, goods account, asset account, see goods account. This is goods account, which I have shown you, purchase account. Same way Pushpa Ben accounts can be created. Particulars, amount. So 40 times the transaction which is taking place with Pushpa Ben, you can record here. Okay. So same way asset account. For example, if I write your building account, then it is an asset account. If I write debtors account, then it is an asset account. If I write purchase account, then it is a goods account. If I write sales account, then it is a goods account. If some party's name is there, then it is known as personal account. Income account. For example, I say commission account. So then it is income account. Expense account. If I say salary, then it is an expense account. So all these different types of accounts are prepared. As per the rules of accounting, even if there is one transaction, respective account is to be prepared. See here they have given example that Pushpa Ben will be having 40 transactions. So it is not like that if there are more number of transactions, then only account is to be prepared. If there is only one transaction also, the account is to be prepared. These terminologies make the subject of the study ease. That is easy. All these terminologies, all these terms that are different terms, we have seen depreciation, bad debt, debtors. Okay. So this, the understanding of this concept makes it easier for you to understand the accounts. The terminologies clearly clarify meanings of the concerned topic so that there is no space for any controversy. It means why there is no controversy? Because in whichever corner of the world you go, debtors, the meaning is same. Creditors, the meaning is same. Transaction, the meaning is same. Economic transaction, the meaning is same. So there is no controversy. Terminologies have significant place and importance in every branch of education. Let us know about the types of accounting system after having studied the meaning, the characteristics and many other things of accounting. Let us start point number 10, method of preparing of accounts. As stated earlier, accounting is a social science. It is essential for this subject to incorporate social changes and new researches. There are two types of accounting in practice. They also keep on changing. Deshinama system is the first one and the second one is double entry system. Both the types are there. Okay. In today's scenario, we can see that there is only use of double entry system most of the times. The organization of the preparation of account under both the type is different. But the rules and principles are identical, that is same. Okay, the method of preparation of both the methods for passing out the entries is different, but the rules are same. Both the types are permissible, both we can see right now. In present time, double entry system is most popular than Deshinama because the accounts are prepared through computer rather than manually written. Computer based accounts are prepared under double entry system. Clear? So here they have mentioned that there are two methods to prepare the accounts. First is Deshinama and second is double entry system. Double entry system is the Western method and Deshinama system is an Indian method, which we are seeing that in many regional areas still there is use of Deshinama. But if you want to handle the accounting entries via computer, you have to do it by double entry system only. We'll see further. See, again here they have shown that is types and basis of accounting system. That is first is double Deshinama system and second is double entry system. And in double entry system there are three methods. First is mercantile base, second is cash base and third is mixed base. First, let me clear you with an example that what do you mean by double entry and what do you mean by Deshinama. I'll just explain one transaction. Okay, first we will see double entry system. Suppose they have given a transaction that is goods
withdrawn for personal use. See this, I am just giving you for an example. You are not clear with the rules right now. I'll just write down the entries just like that. This entry is how to write down. You will learn in the next chapters. Okay, so here what will be the transaction? If this is the transaction and I want to pass the journal entry with this double entry system method, then see how the journal entry will take place. This is the format of journal entry. Okay, see here. Now this is your serial number, particulars, LF, debit and credit. This is the format of journal entry. Now here, what will be the journal entry for this transaction? That is goods withdrawn for personal use. You are withdrawing for personal use, so the transaction is number one. Here what you will do, so drawings account debited to purchase account. How this effect is coming, that I'll teach you later on. Right now just understand that how to pass the entry in double entry system. Okay, this will be the entry, that is drawings account debited to purchase account. Suppose the goods are worth rupees 5000, so here what you'll write down, debit side 5000 and credit side 5000. Okay, so this is the entry, how it takes place in double entry system. Now I'll show you the same transaction, how it will be done in Deshinama system. See now how it takes place in Deshinama. So in Deshinama, first you have to prepare the folds. Okay, in your part 2 of accounts you will learn, but you are not supposed to learn how to pass the entries, only the, that is theoretical discussion will take place. Okay, so like this, 8 folds are to be prepared in Deshinama, and in Deshinama there are no lines in the book, they are blank pages. Okay, see, like this you will prepare 8 folds. Okay, this side here, this is debit, this is credit. Here you have to write down like this, that is jama. First 4 part is for jama and the next part, that is udhar. Okay, first 4 part is for jama, next 4 part is for udhar. Here jama means credit and here udhar means debit. See, in journal entry debit comes first then credit, whereas in Deshinama jama comes first and then udhar comes, that is credit comes first and then debit comes first. Okay, so see here what will be the transaction. See what you have done, drawings account debited. Okay, so drawings is debited, so drawing will come this side. How you will write down? So see, you will write down like this, Shri drawings, drawings are known as ghar kharch, so Shri ghar kharch khate udhar. What is the amount? So 5000, this is the olayo which has been kept between amount and paisa. Then here you will write down the narration, that is withdrawn, that you will write down in English, withdrawn for personal use. Okay, and then you will write down LF. See, your LF column is here, your LF column will be this side. Okay, now next is purchase. Purchase is on which side? So it is on credit side. So here on credit side you will write down, that is Shri Khareed Khate Jama. Okay, so it was Shri Khareed Khate Jama. Okay, again here you will write down, that is 5000, here also 5000, same goods withdrawn for personal use and then LF. Okay, so in Deshinama the entry is passed like this, in double entry the entry is passed like this. Okay, so I hope the concept is clear to you. Now see, we will see further. Deshinama system
It is an ancient method of writing accounts. Generally, it was used by sole proprietor and partnership. Gradually, the use of this system is getting reduced. Under this system, how accounts are prepared, which accounts of books are maintained, information in this context is discussed in the subsequent chapters. That is in part 2 of your accounts textbook. You will see this lesson. Okay. Then, double entry system. According to historians, the mathematician of Italy, that is Luca Pacioli, is considered as the father of the double entry system. Previously also I told you that this is Western method which we are using nowadays, that is double entry system. And who was the father of a double entry system? So the mathematician from Italy, that is Luca Pacioli. Remember this for your objective question. The understanding of double entry system is based on the rules of debit and credit. Basically, there are three rules of debit and credit which are discussed in the detail in subsequent chapter. Okay, that is also given to you that there are three rules. The first rule is related to real account. Second rule is related to personal account. And the third rule is related to nominal account, which we'll see further in the next chapter. A correct and full understanding of this rule is a correct and full understanding of double entry system. If you are efficient and if you are knowing efficiently very clearly these rules are clear in your mind, then you can easily pass on the entries by double entry system. Under the double entry system, what will be the debit and credit effect of each transaction is included in these rules. Okay, in these rules, they have clearly specified that what items will be debited and what items will be credited. To prepare accounts under double entry system, three different bases are used. First is mercantile base, second is cash base, and third is mixed base. First, we'll see that is mercantile base. Mercantile base is also known as accrual. Under this method, when accounts are prepared, all transactions of that respective year are considered. See what they have stated, all transactions under this method is considered. Okay. In the transactions of that accounting year, transactions pertaining to receipt, payment, liability and assets are included. That is all the types of receipts, what you are receiving, what you are paying, what are your liabilities and what are your assets. Everything is being coming into consideration. Income and expenses of respective accounting year are considered. Respective means for that particular year you have to consider. Whereas outstanding income, expenses paid in advance, expenses outstanding, income received in advance, etc. are included. So all this is also included in that. Okay, whatever you are paying, that is outstanding expenses are there, outstanding incomes are there, pre-received income or prepaid, that is you are paying in advance, everything is considered. The income and expense of that particular financial year only are considered. Now see what they're, that is the income and expenses of that particular financial year only are considered. It includes the receivable income of the current year and the payable expenses of the current year. What they are mentioning here, that only the items which are related to current year, that only you have to include. Cash income and expenses related transaction of previous year or next year are not considered to determine profit and loss. Whatever you are paying for the previous year or whatever you are paying for the upcoming year, that you are not supposed to consider. The transaction of the previous year are recorded in previous year and the transaction of the next year will be recorded in the next year. For example, see, assume that accounts are prepared for the year, that is 1/4/2015 to 31/3/2015, and salary of 5000 is paid every month. Further, assume that salary of March is outstanding. It will be considered as under. See what they have told, salary paid for 11 months. Clear? Because they have further assumed that salary is outstanding. So March is not paid. So the salary is only for the 11 months. So one monthly salary is 5,000. So for 11 months, it will be 55,000. How much it is outstanding? So for 1 month, it is outstanding. That will be 5,000. So what it will come? That is 60,000 will be considered as an expense for the year 2014 and 15. So here you will consider the salary which is outstanding for the current year. As it is for the current year period, you have to add it up. Next, see further what they have given. In practice, excluding certain sectors, in all the sectors, the accounts are maintained under mercantile, that is accrual system. So remember this also, that normally except a few of the certain sectors, most of the time, which method is used? So mercantile accrual system is used. This is very popular method. All the chapter in this books are presented on the basis of this method. Next is see cash or receipt based. See, the cash word itself say that whenever only cash transaction takes place, that only you are supposed to take into consideration. Under this method, the accounts of whichever accounting year are being prepaid, only all cash transactions of that respective account year are recorded. Cash transaction of that respective accounting year include transactions pertaining to receipt, payment, liability and asset. The cash transaction of previous year and the current year are also considered. The use of this method is very limited. Okay, here in this particular method you are supposed to see only whenever the cash is paid or cash is received, whether it is of this year or previous year, you have to consider it. Third method, that is hybrid method, mixed method. This method is identified as modified method of mercantile system. It is known as a mixture of mercantile system and cash system. This method is not popular in India. Generally, the companies maintain their accounts under the mercantile system as per the standard 1. The companies give certificate of the accounts are prepared as per the mercantile base. So this method is not very much popular in India. Next we will see, that is steps to prepare accounts. See, what are the steps to prepare account? First of all, what will be there? Voucher will be there. Voucher means there will be bill. So whenever the transaction takes place, that is if you do some purchase or if you do some sales, what is there? So bill is there, bill is prepared. Then identification of transaction. On the basis of that bill, you will identify that which type of transaction it is. Either it is purchase or it is sales or some expenses are paid or some incomes are received. So what is that transaction? So identification will be on the basis of this bill. Next, what you will do, you will pass on the journal entry. Okay, next what you will do, you will give the ledger posting. That all you will learn in future. Next, after ledger posting, what takes place? So trial balance is coming and there are few adjustments. And on the basis of trial balance, what is to be done? That is final account is to be prepared. In final account, what is there? So trading account, profit and loss account and balance sheet is there. See, accounts is a science developed by human being. Accounts is one type of science which is developed by human being. Okay. Since accounting is science, it has its own rules. In accounting, the operation regarding the preparation of account is made. Operations are made on the basis of rules when accounts are prepared as per the different developed steps. These steps are followed in a chronological order. Chronological order means you cannot change the steps. See, the first step, that is voucher. Voucher is the first step of business transaction, which is a valid written document of transaction made. Okay, we are supposed to see these steps only. Second step is what? Identification of transaction, which I explained that you will study the bill, and then you will decide whether it is which type of transaction, purchase, sales, expense or income, and in that case you will also see whether it is cash transaction or credit transaction. When transaction of a business is economic or non-economic, whether the transaction is cash or credit is determined at this stage. So that you will find out. Then see the third step. Third step is recording of transaction. After understanding that which type of transaction it is, what you will do? You will record the transaction in the journal entry. Fourth step is, that is ledger posting. Transactions recorded in general or subsidiary book are classified through the posting in a ledger. It is managed that the transaction of that account can be availed at one place, so that we can find out all the details at one place. You will understand that this all concept later on very nicely, because you will do the sums, practical sums on this. Next is trial balance. In trial balance, all the balances and accounts are disclosed. In fourth stage they are disclosed. It is the prior stage of the preparation of final account. So if trial balance is not there, you cannot prepare the final account. So for the preparation of final account or annual account, both are one and the same, trial balance is the base. That is, trial balance is very important for the preparation of annual account, and trial balance cannot be there if ledger posting is not there. Ledger posting is not possible if journal entry is not there. So the whole process takes place. That is, voucher is important. From voucher you will understand the transaction. From transaction, after understanding, you will pass on the journal entries, then you will do the ledger posting, then you will prepare the trial balance, and on that basis only you can prepare the final account. See, last step, sixth step, that is final account. This are prepared on the basis of the trial balance and adjustment where trading account, P&L account and balance sheet are included. So suppose if the question is there, what is included in annual account? So what is included in annual account? Annual account consists of trading account, profit and loss account and balance sheet. Apart from this, other aspects which are associated with accounts like bank balance, rectification of error, depreciation, reserves and provisions are studied simultaneously. Okay, bank balance, that is whatever the balance you are having in the bank. Rectification of error, that is if some mistake is taking place, how you will rectify that error. Depreciation, that is a gradual decrease in the value of asset which takes place. Reserves and provisions, that is the money which you are keeping aside. All this concept you will study in detail later on. Right now only this much is there for this chapter. Here the chapter gets over. Still, if you have any confusion, you can ask all the points, whatever your confusions are there, please do ask. Thank you.